genitori. Siamo a pagina 18.
Of the liturgy text. In prayer this morning, we'll be assisted by Father Thomas Marfitz, General Superior of the Lazarus Fathers, and Sister Patricia Morbre, who is the Secretary of the Union of Superiors General.
Emite spiritum tuum et creabuntur. Oremus. Deus, qui corda fidelium sancti spiritus illustratione docuisti, da nobis in eodem spiritu recta sapere, et de eius semper consolatione gaudere. Per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen. Sediamoci.
Let us sit.
Reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. So be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and handed himself over for us as a sacrificial offering to God for a fragrant aroma. Immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be mentioned among you, as is fitting among holy ones. No obscenity or silly or suggestive talk which is out of place, but instead, thanksgiving. Be sure of this, that no immoral or impure or greedy person, that is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty arguments, for because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the disobedient. So do not be associated with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for light produces every kind of goodness and righteousness and truth. Try to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the fruitless works of darkness, but rather expose them. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Mi sento come un.
I feel like a beggar at the door of the castle, a beggar for truth, for justice, for light. And all I get is silence and the smallest pieces of information which I have to extract. I get tired and worn out. It's like they hide behind their walls, their dignity, their roles that I don't understand. It hurts because I was abused, because they don't tell the truth, and because those who should be ministers of truth and light hide in darkness.
Alziamoci in piedi.
Let us rise.
Dio santo,
Holy God, you've called us to holiness and sent us to the people as witnesses of your truth. You have enlightened us with the light of the gospel, and want us to live as children of the light. we beseech you, give us the courage to speak the truth and the freedom to profess our responsibility. Save us from the temptation to deny crimes and conceal injustice. And give us the strength to start ever anew and not give up when sin and guilt obscure the light of the gospel. Strengthen our trust in your Son, who alone is the way, the truth, and the life. Your name be praised for all eternity.
Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra, panem nostrum quotidianum odie, et dimite nobis debita nostra, sicut nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentatione, sed libera nos a malo.
Domino Covicum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sit nomen Domini benedictum.
Ex hoc nunc et usque in saeculum.
Adiutorium nostrum in nomine Domini. Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Cari fratelli, cari sorelle.
Dear brothers and sisters, we've come to the third day of our proceedings. And this morning, we will have as the first presentation one that is entitled Openness, or rather, it's not entitled that, but it's about openness sent out into the world, and it's about transparency and how our mission into the world makes us open up and calls upon us to be transparent. We're going to hear from Sister Veronica Openibo, who is the Superior General of the Society of the Holy Child Jesus. She's from Nigeria. And she entered her congregation back in 1973, and she has a longstanding experience as an educator and was also involved in the area of pastoral care and social work. She's a member of the steering committee of the Union of Superiors General, and she's the vice chair of SEDOS, which is the Service of Documentation and Studies on the Global Mission. You have the floor, Sister Veronica, and thank you for being with us.
Papa Francesco, my brothers and sisters, good morning. I begin this talk with a quotation from Luke chapter 4, For me, openness to the world as a consequence of the Ecclesia mission is the mission statement of Jesus that we also follow. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me and anointed me to preach good news to the poor. The Spirit has sent me to proclaim deliverance to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the Lord's year of favor. For me, as a result of the self-understanding of a mission in the world today, the church needs to update and create new systems and practices that will promote action without fear of making mistakes. Clerical sex abuse is a crisis that has reduced the credibility of the church when transparency should be the hallmark of mission as followers of Jesus Christ. The fact that many accuse the Catholic Church today of negligence is disturbing. The church must do everything possible to protect its young and vulnerable members. The focus should not be on fear or disgrace, but rather on the church's mission to serve with integrity and justice. The mission of the church flows directly from our deepest understanding of the incarnation. Catholic Christianity is grounded in belief in a God who chose to be one with the human world. The self-understanding of the mission of the church must be a manifestation of the Christ we know as both human and divine. The whole of Christ's mission was to reveal who God is and who we can become. This implies a total acceptance of all that is human and all that the power of God's grace does to transform us into being witnesses of the divine. Our worldview, if Christian, must be based on respect and dignity for each human being. At the present time, we are in a state of crisis and shame. We have seriously clouded the grace of the Christ mission. Is it possible for us to move from fear of scandal to truth? How do we remove the mask that hides our sinful neglect? What policies, programs, and procedures will bring us to a new, revitalized starting point, characterized by a transparency that lights up the world with God's hope for us in building the reign of God? Throughout the time of writing this presentation, my eyes were cloudy, and I wondered what this could mean. Then I remembered the first time I watched the movie Spotlight. Some of you know it. The 2016 American biographical drama about the investigation by Boston Globe in America, in Boston area. The cover up by ecclesia authorities. At the end of the film was a long list of cases and dioceses where they occurred, and reading about the number of children affected, and also later seeing the vast amount of money spent on settlements, tears of sorrow flowed. How could the clerical church have kept silent, covering these atrocities? The silence, the carrying of the secrets in the hearts of the perpetrators, the length of the abuses we heard one last night, and the constant transfers of perpetrators are unimaginable. Presumably, there were significant signs in the confessional and in spiritual direction. I want to believe that. With a heavy and sad heart, I think of all the atrocities we have committed as members of the church. I'm saying we, not they, we. The constitutions of my congregation reminds me, in Christ we unite ourselves to the whole of humanity, especially to the poor and suffering. We accept our share of responsibility for the sin of the world and so live that his love may prevail. I think all of us must acknowledge that our mediocrity, hypocrisy, and complacency have brought us to this disgraceful and scandalous place that we find ourselves as a church. We pause to pray, Lord, have mercy on us. In Gaudete Exultet 164, we read that those who think they commit no grievous sins against God's laws can fall into a state of dull lethargy, since they see nothing serious to reproach themselves with. They fail to realize that their spiritual life has gradually turned lukewarm. They end up weakened and corrupted. Let us not say they, it's all of us. So many aspects of this statement from Pope Francis stand out for me on the issue of child abuse, as also these sentences from the PCB preparation document. A church that is closed, shut off, is no longer a church. A mission will be thwarted. It is not about giving up principles and secularizing the church. It is about living visibly and perceptibly what we claim to be or what and how we really are. Yes, we proclaim the Ten Commandments and parade ourselves as being the custodians of moral standards and values and good behavior in the society. Hypocrites at times, yes, but why did we keep silent for so long? How can we turn this around for a time to evangelize, catechize, and educate all the members of the church, including the clergy and religious? I often asked myself, is it true that most bishops did nothing about the sexual abuse of children? I want to believe, and from what I've read, some did act, and some did not, out of fear or cover-up. We might say the church is now taking steps to arrest the situation, but also to be more transparent about all the steps it had been taking privately over two decades, such as meeting with victims of sexual abuse, reporting cases to the appropriate civil authorities, and setting up commissions and many other things. The question today is more about how to address the issue of the sexual abuse of minors more directly, transparently, and courageously as a church. The hierarchical structure and systems in the church, I believe, should be a blessing for us to reach the whole world with very clear mechanism to address this and many other issues. Why has this not happened enough? Why have other issues around sexuality not been addressed sufficiently? For example, the misuse of power, misuse of money, clericalism, we've heard that many times, gender discrimination, the role of women and the laity in general. Is it that the clerical structures and long protocols that negatively affect swift actions focused more on media reactions? I have a reflection. I would like to offer some reflection based on the experience as an African woman religious. I've lived in Rome for 15 years, off and on, and studied in America for 3. So I am familiar with these issues in the global north. Probably like many of you, I've heard some Africans and Asians say, or many Africans and Asians say, that this is not an issue in the countries in Africa and Asia. It is the problem in Europe, the Americas, Canada, and Australia. However, I worked throughout Nigeria in the area of sexuality education for 9 years and heard stories and counseled many people. In fact, one of the bishops, the first to invite me to his diocese to speak with him, have a workshop with him and his priest, is present here, Archbishop Akubueze. So he saw the need and invited me. I realized how serious the issues were and still are, and sharing a few of my personal experiences emphasize this fact. In the early 90s, a priest told me there were sexual abuses in the convents and formation houses, and that as president of the Nigerian Women Religious, I should please do something to address the issue. A second priest in early 2000 said that a particular ethnic group practiced a lot of incest. But I added to him that from my personal experience, incest is a world issue. A dying old man revealed to me he was acting strangely because of the sexual abuse he experienced as a teenager from the priest in his school. And recently, I heard from somebody, another person had the same experience. So it must have been something that was going on in the school for years. The same school. A 13-year-old girl met a priest attacker 25 years later, and he did not recognize her. These are just short stories. So let us not hide such events anymore because of the fear of making mistakes. Too often, we want to keep silent until the storm has passed. This storm will not pass. Our credibility as a church is at stake. I think Jesus told us, gave us a very strong statement. Whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him if a great millstone were put around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. Mark chapter 9:42. So, my dear brothers and sisters, we must face this issue and seek healing for the victims of abuse. The normal process for clergy in the past and still in the present in some areas was and is to give support to one of us to avoid exposing scandal and bringing discredit to the church. I told my group yesterday I used to use 3 S's. It's secrecy, it's silence, and the last one is solidarity for men and support for one of us. Women is the same, but the third one is different. You can ask me later. We must face this issue and seek healing for the victims of abuse. The normal process, as I said, is the support for men, but we find a way together. All offenders, I want to say, regardless of their clerical status, found guilty should be given the same penalty for the abuse of minors. Let us have courageous conversations rather than saying nothing to avoid making a mistake. I like this statement. We can make a mistake, but we are not created to be a mistake. And mind you, posterity will judge us for not taking action. The first step towards true transparency is to admit wrongdoing and then to publish what has been done. I repeat, we publish what has been done. I think some of it has been published already, but we have to make it public. What has been done since the time of John Paul II to heal the situation? It may not be enough, sufficient in the eyes of many, but it will show that the church had not been totally silent. We must build more effective and efficient processes based on research in human development. I hear we use here human formation, as well as civil and canon law for the safeguarding of minors. Then give clear and comprehensive safeguarding policies and guidelines in every diocese that should be placed visibly in various parish offices and published on the internet. There must be better handling of the cases through face-to-face, transparent and courageous conversation with both victims and offenders where possible, as well as investigating groups. In many parts of the world, including countries in Africa and Asia, not saying anything is a terrible mistake, as we have seen in many countries. The fact that there are huge issues of poverty, illness, war, and violence in some countries in the global south does not mean that the area of sexual abuse should be downplayed or ignored. The church has to be proactive in facing it. I read through some of the papers that were given out to us in various parts of the world. Many dioceses and conferences have written books. I didn't see Nigeria in it, but I know I worked with some of the booklets that the bishops produce in Nigeria, Call to Love, I Chose You, Guidelines for Processing Abuse of Minors and Vulnerable Adults. We need more of such in many parts of the world. The excuse that respect be given to some priests by virtue of their advanced years and a hierarchical position is unacceptable. This argument states that many of the criminal offenders are old, some no longer alive, and that we should not hurt them or their reputations by taking away their priesthood in old age. We can feel sad for those who, when they were younger, committed offenses that are now being brought out to the open. But my heart bleeds for many of the victims who have lived with the misplaced shame, we heard that yesterday, misplaced shame and guilt of repeated violations for years. In some of these areas, the offenders did not even see the victims as persons, but as objects. It is true as a church that we believe in repentance of the sinner, in conversion of hearts, and the grace of transformation. As Jesus said to the woman caught in the very act of adultery, go and from now on do not sin anymore. This can create a strong dilemma for some, especially when we know that abusers have often been victims themselves. Do we need to probe deeply what we mean by justice with compassion? How can we help create the environment for prayer and discernment for the grace of God to enlighten us in the way of justice so that transformation and healing may take place for both victims and, I want to say, offenders? We will need to find out where throughout the world, not only in wealthier countries, are the best practices for doing this being developed and can we implement them? Many of these are to be found within the church. I think we've heard that in many of our small groups. In publishing the names of offenders, can we publish a complete set of information regarding these situations? I want to suggest some strategic way forward. It is becoming evident that victims that were listened to and helped psychologically and spiritually were healed. Can we train enough sensitive and compassionate people to offer this service in all countries, including those places struggling to put food on the table? Are there ways of helping parishes heal victims using their traditional wisdom? Do we make use of preaching and other means to address sexual issues in society? How might dioceses share a strategic way in providing culturally sensitive education programs and training kits? Such materials, respecting the dignity of the human persons and emphasizing unacceptable behaviors, could be used in parishes and schools, hospitals, and other places of pastoral ministry. The UISG and USD has promised that in the statement they made. How can we continue to address in very concrete ways the issues of prostitution and trafficking on an immense scale, as well as personal infidelity and promiscuity around the world? There must be Catholics, along with others with similar principles, in positions of influence in, for example, the film industry, TV, and advertising. They could be encouraged to come together and reflect on their role in promoting a better view of the human person. Let there be a focus on society's disservice to men in every patriarchal culture in the area of sexuality. From studies I've discovered, and many have discovered, that for a long time, society accepted promiscuity, infidelity, especially in marriage for men. But it's changing, thank God. Let us investigate how better to use social media to educate people on the whole area of sexuality and human relationships. I want to say here, essential, surely, is a clear and balanced education and training about sexuality boundaries in the seminaries and formation houses. In the ongoing formation of priests, religious men and women, and bishops. It worries me when I see in Rome and elsewhere, my country included, the youngest seminarians being treated as though they are more special than everyone else. Thus, ideas about their status, exalted ideas about their status. This is encouraged because they assume they have already high status. The study of human development, human formation, must give rise to a serious question about the existence of minor seminaries. I want to repeat that. The study of human development, human formation, must give rise to a serious question about the existence of minor seminaries. The formation of young women religious too can often lead to a false sense of superiority over their lay sisters and brothers, that their calling is a higher one. What damage has that thinking done to the mission of the church? Have we forgotten the reminder by Vatican II in Gaudium et Spes of the universal call to holiness? In addition, we need to ask responsible and sensitive lay people and women religious to give true and honest evaluation of candidates for episcopal appointments. Could each diocese be challenged to gather men and women of integrity, laity, including religious and clergymen, to form a joint commission sharing expertise about the documentary procedures and protocols, the legal and financial implications of allegations, and the necessary channels of responsibility and accountability. A well-qualified person, lay religious or priest, is likely to be the best chairperson of such a group. In addition, they need to work out how best to face the serious issues of sexual abuse already exploding in some Asian and African countries in the same way that it has already elsewhere. Many people who were sexually abused by priests or others in pastoral positions will suffer as traumatic memories are invoked. Some people will be reminded that they could well be revealed as former or current abusers or accused of covering up such facts. Many in various forms of ministry will come across people, family members, adults, and or children who have been or are being abused and need to know how to respond appropriately. Some allegations will be false, which causes sufferings of another kind. The impact of damaged faith in the church cannot be underemphasized, as a large number of Catholics are and will be angry and confused. We've seen that in some parts of the world. People in positions of some authority also need to know what to say or do in terms of response when issues get to the media or to the press. Conclusion. We know that the greatest issue is the proclamation of the gospel in a way that will touch the hearts of the young and old. We are called to proclaim the good news, but we must be good news to the people we serve today. No wonder Pope Francis has declared the month of October 2019 as the extraordinary missionary month. I come back to my opening passage. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me and anointed me. As an indicator or postscript, I emphasize the following. The Spirit of the Lord is upon each one of us, and especially those present here, has anointed all of us. We've heard that during the reports from groups that yes, we are here for serious business and issues are being taken care of. To preach the good news to the poor being the vulnerable, protecting especially defenseless children, seeking justice for the victims of abuse, and taking steps to prevent this abuse from recurring. To proclaim the deliverance to the captives, for me, the perpetrators are in need of deliverance, conversion, and transformation. And we shouldn't forget that. And recovery of sight to the blind. To those who are not seeing the issues, even some of us present here, or focusing on protecting our own, or keeping silent, or covering up, need recovery of sight. To release the oppressed and to proclaim the Lord's year of favor by taking the necessary steps and maintaining zero tolerance with regard to sexual abuse, we will release the oppressed. This is our year of favor. Let us courageously take up the responsibility to be truly transparent and accountable. Returning to the title of this conference, I just want to say that one passage that has inspired me is, "You are the light of the world." I think we had a line like that this morning in the prayer. A city set on a mountain cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and then put it under a bushel basket. It is set on a lampstand where it gives light to all the house. Just so your light must shine before others, that they may see your goodies and glorify your heavenly Father. I read with great interest many articles about the Pope's reaction in the case of the Chilean bishops. I think you remember the story. From a denial of accusations to anger because of the deception the Pope felt and the cover-up, to the acceptance of resignations of, I thought three, but I read again, two of the bishops. I admire you, Brother Francis, for taking time as a true Jesuit to discern and be humble enough to change your mind, to apologize and take action. This is an example for all of us. Thank you, Pope Francis, for providing this opportunity for us to check and see where we have acted strangely, ignorantly, secretly, and complacently. I believe we will change with great determination our total approach to reporting abuse, to supporting the victims, to getting the right people to mentor and give support to the victims, and above all, to doing what we can to protect minors and vulnerable adults from any form of abuse. Thank you too for providing women religious through the executive of the Union of Superiors General an opportunity to participate in this conference. It's the first time ever that we've had all the members of the executive of the women come to a meeting like this. Usually the men come, but the women, we were told, pick three people and they must be this, this, this. Women, I must say, have acquired a lot of useful experience to offer us in this field. And we've already done much to support victims. There are women who are also offenders. And also to work creatively on their own use of power and authority. I hope and pray that at the end of this conference, we will choose deliberately to speak, to break any culture of silence and secrecy among us, to allow more light into our church. As the mother church, a mother takes care of the children and continues to be a mother to take care of the children. Let us acknowledge our vulnerability. Be proactive, not reactive, in combating the challenges facing the world of the young and the vulnerable. And look fearlessly into other issues of abuse in the church and society. I want to end with this by reminding ourselves of Pope Francis' own words. A Christian who does not move forward has an identity that is not well. The gospel is clear. The Lord sent them out saying, go, go forward. The Christian walks, moves past difficulties, and announces that the kingdom of God is near. I pray we will move forward past this difficulty surely. Thank you.
Thank you. Grazie mille, Suor Veronica, per questo.
Thank you so much.